بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، والحمد لله رب العالمين، وصلى الله على محمد وآله الطيبين الطاهرين، ولعنة الله على أعدائهم إلى أبد الآبدين. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. In the previous episode, my dear brothers and sisters, we talked and spoke about the difficulties that the messengers and prophets of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and their successors and their families had to go through just because they were sent to guide mankind on the face of this earth, and they represented Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who sent them down with these messages, and that these messages were merely there to protect mankind and to guide them towards the right path. These messages were not there to deprive mankind of their lives or their livelihood or to take away anything of their lives. But these messages are there and were there and will be there for the good of mankind. So they live life in this world in the best of ways, in the best of protections, in the best of rights, and their rights will be protected, and it will protect their lives as well, until they leave and depart this life, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala want them to live in the hereafter forever, in the paradise, in the gardens that Allah had allocated for every single one of us. And we recited some of the verses that described the position and the purification that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had granted and purified the progeny of the Holy Prophet of Islam. And amongst the narrations that we discussed in the previous episodes was that the narration that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam narrated, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had three sacred sanctities, and whomever protected those sacred sanctities, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was going to protect their religion, their life in the hereafter, and their life in this life. And whomever neglected to protect those sanctities, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will neglect and will not grant his protection. And we explained that there were individuals at the time of the Holy Prophet of Islam that were hypocrites, were munafiqeen, amongst the so-called Muslims that used to live in the city of Mecca and Medina. Specifically in the city of Medina, there were individuals who had embraced Islam just because of their worldly interests and desires. They saw Islam and they saw the position of prophethood and being a messenger and or being a representative of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and leading the Muslims in this life. They saw it to be, it's as if it was a monarchy. It was a leadership contest that they wanted to take or succeed the Holy Prophet after him and become the next monarch or the next king or the next emperor. And this is what actually did happen after numerous occasions during the 21 years that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam, on many occasions, on many different platforms and many locations in Mecca and Medina, did actually speak about the position of his successor and his cousin Ali ibn Abi Talib, and the fact that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had chosen him to be his leader and the Imam and the Khalifa after the Holy Prophet, peace be upon him and his holy progeny. But there were those individuals who did not take those statements and those words seriously. They thought, and they actually believed, that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam, the Holy Messenger of Islam, was actually making those statements just to position and to give power and to give leadership to his cousin. Those individuals, those hypocrites, did not actually believe in the prophethood of Rasulullah, the Holy Prophet of Islam. They were just Muslims by name. Apparently, in front of all the Muslims, in front of the Holy Prophet, they were Muslims. But inside their hearts, they did not actually practice or believe in Islam. That's why we will come to see and read from the authentic narrations that they themselves narrate. The other schools of thought narrate in their books, and the books that they actually follow and believe that they are authentic, and their authenticity is 100%. These narrations, and what actually these individuals, those hypocrites who came and stole leadership of Ali ibn Abi Talib, and they threatened and they frightened the people of Medina and the household of the Holy Prophet, and they killed many just for the sake of seeking leadership and assuming power upon the Muslims. In the book Al-Aqd Al-Farid, now I mentioned these historical books and these references for our brothers and sisters to go and research. Those who might not have heard these narrations before. Brothers and sisters, I narrate to you these references, and please go and read and check. Because upon going and investigating and opening these references, you will come to understand those individuals who came in the name of Islam and who came and forced people by the power of sword to pay allegiance to them and sat upon the shoulders and the necks and the heads of the Muslims and assumed leadership. And they did not deserve by any means to be leaders upon the Muslims. They did not have the knowledge, they did not have the attributes to be leaders upon the Muslims. On which grounds these individuals came and assumed leadership, and they moved away those who leadership was meant for them. They cleared them away, they forced them, they terrified them, they terrorized them, and they attacked and killed and shed their blood just for the sake of assuming power and leadership and sitting on the throne that they had sought to sit on in the lifetime of the Holy Prophet. Many of them participated in assassination attempts to kill the Holy Prophet, but these assassination attempts did not succeed. Until the last assassination attempt succeeded, when Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam fell ill. And those hypocrites whom were in the house of Rasulullah, they were amongst of the closest of individuals to the Holy Prophet. They played a role to assassinate the Holy Prophet. Rasulullah had ordered all the Muslims to go out and join the army of Osama, and he cursed the one that does not attend and join the army of Osama. There was a group of those hypocrites who stayed behind and did not engage and join in the army of Osama, just for the sole reason of continuing and completing the assassination attempt of the Holy Prophet of Islam. In the book Al-Aqd Al-Farid, juz' number 2, page number 250, and in the book Tariq Abil Fida, juz' 1, chapter 1, page number 156 وأعلام النساء chapter 3 page 1207 this narration is narrated. وبعث إليهم أبو بكر عمر بن الخطاب وقال لهم فإن أبوا فقاتلوهم أو فاقتلوهم وأقبل عمر بقبس من نار على أن يضرب عليهم الدار فلقيته فاطمة عليه السلام this عليه السلام is from me فقالت يا ابن الخطاب أجئت لتحرق دارنا قال نعم أو تدخل فيما دخل فيه الأمة now what is this narration about after the hypocrites poisoned the Holy Prophet of Islam now here I am cutting everything very short I am compressing all the historical events in this very minute session and I leave everything to you you can go and investigate and read and research in these references that I had mentioned so we come to understand what really actually happened when Rasulullah fell ill and he ordered that no one should give him any type of medicine the two women the two wives of the Holy Prophet they upon orders from their fathers they came when the Holy Prophet of Islam had lost consciousness they came and placed ladood which is a type of medicine they put under the tongue or the side of the mouth of the ill patient and they had actually poisoned that piece of medicine and that occurred when Rasulullah was unconscious they poisoned the Holy Prophet and the Prophet's health deteriorated more and more until he became a martyr and departed this life Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam was taken by Ali ibn Abi Talib for preparation for burial, for washing, for ghusl, for takfeen, shrouding and burial. In the process of these 3 days, all the munafiqeen, the hypocrites, they came in the area called Saqifat Bani Sa'idah. They brought the heads of the clans and the heads of the Muslims and they positioned Abu Bakr ibn Abi Quhafa to be the so-called leader of the Holy Prophet of Islam. And they claimed that this decision was made by the Shura, by the gathering, by the committee of the heads of the Muslims. Whilst they knew and they had heard the Holy Prophet even in the last moments of his life Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam had advised and had reminded and ordered the ummah, the nation and had pinpointed the individuals to follow Ali ibn Abi Talib as he is going to be the successor after him and the majority of those individuals who participated in that so-called election process who was not valid who was wrong from the beginning they were present at the event of Ghadir Khum where Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam ordered the Muslims halfway between Mecca and Medina in the area called Ghadir Khum to call all of those individuals who had passed them and to wait for all of the Muslims to reach that area and the Holy Prophet of Islam stood there in the middle of the heat of the desert in the middle of the day and delivered a sermon, a speech in which he recited this verse اليوم أكملت لكم دينكم وأتممت عليكم نعمتي ورضيت لكم الإسلام دينا and today I have completed for you your religion and that day Rasulullah upon orders from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala He conveyed to the Muslims that, oh Muslims, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, I have to convey to you this statement. And the fact that Ali ibn Abi Talib is your Amir and your Mawla and the Khalifa after me. And Rasulullah, the Holy Prophet of Islam, in Ghadir Khum, recited this prayer, Allahumma wali man walah, wa adi man adah, wa ansur man nasarah, wa khdhul man khadalah. ألا من كنت مولاه فهذا علي مولاه اللهم والي من والاه وعادي من عاداه. And the Holy Prophet stayed there for 3 days, and the Muslims and all the leaders of the Muslims and the tribes came and paid allegiance. They shook the hands of the Holy Prophet and they shook the hands of Ali ibn Abi Talib to pay allegiance and to bear witness that Ali ibn Abi Talib is going to be their leader after the Holy Prophet of Islam. Coming back to the city of Medina after the demise and the martyrdom of Rasulullah, while Ali ibn Abi Talib and a group of Bani Hashim, the close relatives of the Holy Prophet and the sincere companions like Salman and Miqdad and Ammar, and a handful of the sincere companions of the Holy Prophet and Amir al-Mu'mineen, were busy preparing the body of the Holy Prophet for burial and the final farewell, there were a group of people occupied and busy in the election process to elect someone to be their leader. Upon choosing Abu Bakr ibn Abi Quhafa to be their leader wrongfully, Ali ibn Abi Talib stayed indoors because everyone knew that Ali ibn Abi Talib was the cousin of the Holy Prophet. And if Ali ibn Abi Talib alayhi salam and Bani Hashim do not come out and pay allegiance to the so-called elected leader of the Muslims, then this leadership is not worth anything. Hence, Abu Bakr ibn Abi Quhafa sent on many occasions, to some narrations 13 times, he sent delegations and he sent individuals to the door of Ali ibn Abi Talib, to the house of Fatima al-Zahra, pressurizing Ali ibn Abi Talib and those in the house of Ali ibn Abi Talib to come and pay allegiance. But Ali ibn Abi Talib did not accept those statements until I recited to you this narration where Abu Bakr ba'atha ilayhim Abu Bakr Umar. Abu Bakr sent Umar ibn al-Khattab wa qala lahum, and Abu Bakr said to Umar ibn al-Khattab and the group of people that he had sent with Umar, قال لهم فإن أبوا فقاتلوهم. And if this time you go to the house of Ali and you say to Ali ibn Abi Talib and the companions that are with him in the house that Abu Bakr says you have to come to the masjid to pay allegiance to him, that he is going to be the leader, and if they disobey you and if they deny that request, you should fight them. فَقَاتِلُوهُمْ وَأَقْبَلَ. Here is the scenario. And this is, as I said, narrated in the references of the books of the Muslims. In Al-Aqd al-Farid, Tariq Abil Fida, A'lam al-Nisa, and many other books. وَأَقْبَلَ عُمَرَ بِقَبَسٍ مِنْ نَارٍ. In the final time, eventually Umar ibn al-Khattab came carrying a torch, a fire. He came so he can burn the door, burn the house upon them. فلقيته فاطمة, فاطمة الزهراء came to the door. فقالت يا ابن الخطاب أو عمر أجئت لتحرق دارنا. Have you come to burn the house? This is the same house that Rasulullah, as I said in the first episode, for 6 months he used to stand by the same door, holding onto the handles of the door. He used to recite this very verse, إِنَّمَا يُرِيدُ اللَّهِ لِيُذْهِبَ عَلِكُمُ الرِّجْسَ أَهْلَ الْبَيْتِ وَيُطَحِرَكُمْ تَطْهِيرًا. Every day for 6 months, the same door. Oh Umar, have you come to burn this house? We are the family. We are one of the sacred sanctities that Rasulullah, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had asked Muslims to protect. Do you not say that you are a Muslim? Show you are a Muslim. Prove to everyone that you are a Muslim. If you say you are a Muslim, then where is your protection of the sacredness and the sanctity of the relatives of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam? How come you are carrying a torch of fire and you have come advancing towards my door and you want to burn the house upon my head? Ya ibn al-Khattab, aji'ta lituhriqa darana? Listen what he replies. Qala na'am, aw tadkhulu fi ma dakhala fihi al-ummah. Oh, you do as the other people have done. They came and paid allegiance to Abu Bakr, and that was done by force. They forced people. They forced them that if you do not, we will kill you. وفي تاريخ الطبري. الطبري is one of the books heavily relied upon by the other schools of thought. جزء ثلاثة, جزء number three, page number 198. And in the book, in the reference الإمامة والسياسة, جزء number 1, page number 13. And in the reference شرح ابن أبي الحديد المعتزلي, chapter 1, page 134, it says that دعا بالحطب وقال, عمر called upon people to bring wood and said, wallah, these wood will burn upon you, this house. أو لتخرجن إلى البيعة وقال والله لتحرقن عليكم أو لتخرجن إلى البيعة أو لتخرجن إلى البيعة أو لأحرقنها على من فيها. فقال للرجل, and he was told, أو عمر, إن فيها فاطمة. فاطمة الزهراء is in the house of عمر. This is the daughter of Rasulullah. This is the beloved daughter of the Holy Prophet of Islam. إلا فيها فاطمة فيقول, and he was narrated saying, وإن, and so what? So what, she is Fatima? Who cares? I want Khilafah. I am here for the sake of leadership. And eventually they burned the door of Fatima al-Zahra. Fatima al-Zahra stood behind the door. And upon them noticing that Fatima was behind the door and the wall, they crushed Fatima al-Zahra. They squeezed Fatima al-Zahra and they pushed the door upon Fatima al-Zahra until one of the nails in the door pierced through the chest of Fatima al-Zahra. Fatima al-Zahra alayhi salam was pregnant with the brother of Hassan al-Hussein, the third son of Amir al-Mu'mineen, by the name of Muhsin. All of these calamities started here when they stood by the door of Fatima al-Zahra and they burned the door and they crushed Fatima al-Zahra between the door and the wall, and the nail pierced into the chest of Fatima al-Zahra. And Fatima al-Zahra, because of the kicking and the beating she received from Umar ibn al-Khattab and the companions with Umar ibn al-Khattab, Fatima al-Zahra miscarried the third son of Ali ibn Abi Talib by the name of Muhsin. They killed the child of Ali ibn Abi Talib. Fatima al-Zahra miscarried Muhsin and he died there and there. And they broke the ribs of Fatima al-Zahra. They slapped Fatima al-Zahra. Fatima al-Zahra fell upon the ground unconscious. They came inside the house. They captured Ali ibn Abi Talib. They tied the ropes of his sword upon his hands and they started pulling Ali ibn Abi Talib towards the mosque. What was the reason that those individuals who in the life of the Holy Prophet called themselves Muslims, who were required to protect the sanctity and the sacredness of Ahlul Bayt, as Rasulullah, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had ordered them to, what caused them to come and stand by the door of Fatima and burn down the door and attack her and cause her to miscarry the son of Ali ibn Abi Talib, the grandson of the Holy Prophet of Islam? Hence, these days, mu'mineen all over the world, they sit down and mourn the death of Al-Muhsin, Al-Shaheed. Not only they attacked and were the cause of the death of Fatima al-Zahra, but they killed there and there the first person from the lineage of Fatima al-Zahra and Ali ibn Abi Talib to be killed by the hands of those so-called hypocrites who stole leadership and khilafah from Ali ibn Abi Talib. They killed the grandson, the third grandson of the Holy Prophet of Islam, Muhsin. Muhsin al-Shaheed. And the calamities and the problems and the tragedies started befalling upon the household of Rasulullah, upon Fatima al-Zahra, upon Amir al-Mu'mineen, upon Hassan al-Hussein. From that day onwards, there became two groups, two parties. Those who were close to the Holy Prophet, the family of the Holy Prophet, Amir al-Mu'mineen and the close companions, and the so-called individuals who congregated in the Saqifah, Ashab al-Saqifah, the people of the Saqifah. And from that day onwards, these two groups were a point where Mu'mineen and Muslims were tested upon. They are either going to stand with Ali ibn Abi Talib or going to take sides with the Ashab al-Saqifah, the companions of the Saqifah. I urge my brothers and sisters whom had not heard and whom have not read these narrations from these references, go and investigate. Do not keep believing these false information that you hear from right, left and center. Go and investigate, go and read, research and listen and ask. Maybe one day you will come to understand the truth and the reality of what happened to the holy household of the Holy Prophet after his martyrdom. وهذا والحمد لله رب العالمين والسلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.